are guests with us this morning in town. We're grateful to have you this morning. Certainly all of the Dahog clan, all the relatives of Gavin are here this morning. Gavin's making his profession of faith, so we're excited about that. Welcome, everybody. It's time to get started with worship. Let's begin with prayer. Please pray with me. And Lord, we've come. After we've missed last week, we've come again. It's good to see one another again. It's good to be here together, but especially, Lord, to be here together and together with you. And we pray that, Lord, you will do in us what we have not expected you to do. Lord, some of us today are walking in here because, Lord, we really need you to comfort us. There's pain in our life, Lord, that we can't shake. There's aches and of our hearts that, Lord, we can't get over, and we need you to comfort us. Lord, some of us are coming into this room today, not knowing it, but realizing my life has zero purpose, and we're aimlessly doing whatever we do. And we pray this morning that you would challenge us, Lord. Challenge us to live a new way, to follow after you. Some of us are coming in here, Lord, not expecting you to do this, but what we need, Lord, is you to convict us. Some of us have made a commitment to you, and Lord, our lives are not reflecting it as we should, and doing what we want to do, and doing what is evil in your sight. Some of us, Lord, need conviction today, because you're calling us to leave our old life behind and follow you, Jesus. Come, challenge, convict, comfort us today, Lord. And through it all, be glorified, exalted, and adored, Lord, through these your people this morning. We love you, and thank you for this time we have together. In your great name we pray. Amen. Friends, I've welcomed you. Turn to a neighbor. Find someone behind you, in front of you, and welcome them in the name of the Lord Jesus.
Joy to the world, the Savior reigns, let never joy. Repeat the sounding joy. Repeat it, repeat the sounding joy. Hear the joyful sound of our offering as your saints bow down, as your people sing. We will rise with you, lifted on your wings, and the world will see that our God saves. Our God saves. There is hope in your name. You rule the world with truth and grace, and made the nations full. The glories of your righteousness, the wonders of your love, the wonders of your love, the wonders, wonders of your love. Hear the joyful sound of our offering as your saints bow down, as your people sing. We will rise with you, lifted on your wings, and the world will see that our God saves. Our God saves. There is hope in your name.
Please pray with me. Lord, you rule the world, balancing and holding together both truth and grace. We love you. In your great name we pray. And all God's people said, amen, amen. Friends, please be seated. Hey, we've got something really special this morning. I'm going to ask Harper Van Matren and her grandma to come. They have something special they want to share with you on the piano. So Harper, grandma, why don't you come on down? You know, a few weeks ago, well, it's been probably a month ago, we said, if anybody, any children have something that they would like to share with all of you, just say so. And well, Harper was the one who said, I'll do something. So Harper and Grandma, please lead us, okay? Thank you. you, thank you, thank you. You know, it's proven time and time again, when younger people are involved and in, within the congregation in intergenerational relationships, that helps solidify them in their relationship with the Lord. So thanks, Harper. Guess how long Harper's been taking piano lessons? Since June. Harper, God's given you a gift to use, and thank you for sharing it with us this morning to His glory and honor and praise. Yeah, it's pretty amazing, huh? All right. Well, there's some great things that are happening, friends, in the life of the church. A few things I want to make sure you know about. If you're a newcomer with us this morning, or you'd like to get involved and invested more, I want to draw your attention to this connection card. This is your opportunity to get connected if you're new with us, and stay connected as well. If you're new with us this morning, you can fill this out with your contact information and bring it to a team member at the welcome table at the glass doors in the back. And back there, that team member has a little gift to say thank you for being here with us this morning. And on the back side, if anybody has need for prayer or like to sign up to be involved a little bit more, you can do that and bring all of those to the welcome table that are in the back. I mentioned earlier that Gavin's doing his profession of faith this morning, so we just rejoice with him, with what God's doing in his life. I want to give you a little heads up for next week, not this coming week, but next week on Monday night. We're gathering as a community for prayer, 7:30 at Sheldon Christian School. This is different from the usual Thursday night, but they have their Christmas program on that evening. So next Monday night, Sheldon Christian School, 7:30, we're gathering for prayer throughout the community. So I want you to be a part of that as well. Now, we're doing a new additional strategy for Christmas Eve, just to invite people to come to Christmas Eve, because there's two times of the year that people will just kind of maybe normally and naturally come to church who don't normally and naturally do that. It's Christmas Eve and Easter. And so we want to be inviting our friends and neighbors to do that. So you've probably seen in the last few days, and maybe you've seen it on your television as well, a little invitation that we've gone and put out there. Shelley, can you run that video for us? And then I'm going to tell you what your part in this is as well.
Hi, I'm Paul Van Maren, the pastor of First Reformed Church in Sheldon. This is my family. We encourage you to attend a local church on Christmas Eve. If you don't have a place to go, we invite you to come to First Reformed. If you haven't been to church in a while or never before, it's okay. We want you to come as you are for our family candlelight service. We'll sing carols, hear a message about Jesus' birth, and leave with hope.
First Reformed is located on the corner of Washington Avenue and 7th Street in Sheldon.
Okay, and your part in this is at the door after our worship time together this morning, members of our First Impression teams has little invite cards. I want you to grab one or two if you like to. Grab one and give it to somebody, a neighbor, a friend, a coworker, you know, a fellow student at school, and invite them to Christmas Eve. You know, I want people in our community who belong to a church to go to your church. But if people have nowhere else to go, I want them to come here, don't you? I want them to be here. And you have a responsibility to be able to help with that. So grab one of these as you go out the door. Now, there is a little bit of a game with this. You got to figure out who's saying those last little words. So as you watch that, it's going to be on ESPN, Lifetime, Hallmark Channel, Fox News, everything that people watch a lot. Figure out who's the person. And if anybody can get back to me who said those words, I'll give you a little prize. Does that sound cool? All right, cool. All right, we're going to turn our hearts to prayer this morning. There's several people we're going to pray for that's inside of your worship program. And so let's bring those to the King, because He's the one who invites us to pray and asks us to pray. So let's seek His face. Please pray with me. And Lord, we bring to You our prayer this morning because You are the Almighty God. You can do anything. You have all power and might. And Lord, not only have power and might to act and work, but Jesus, You have power and might in this world to do more than what we could ever ask or imagine. You are the one who knows all things, knowing not only the events of the world, but knowing, Lord, what moves our hearts and draws us to Yourself. Lord, You are the one who is not only knowledgeable and powerful, but Lord, You are present as well, everywhere. And there's not a place in heaven above or on earth below that we couldn't go that You aren't there. And we praise You for that. And we praise You, Lord, because You are the Almighty God and that You invite us to pray, that You would act and move in the lives of those for whom we pray today, knowing full well there's many of us, Lord, where our prayers aren't going to be spoken aloud, but Lord, You know them as they reside in our hearts. We specifically pray, Lord, for Clara Boone, for healing, Lord, from her little bout with the hospital in this past week. Stretch out your hand to heal. We pray for our sister Inky and our brother Darren for the loss of Inky's sister. And I ask that, Lord, you would heal them in their midst of grief and loss. And many of us, Lord, are experiencing, you know, the loss of someone, some loved one. And in this season of the year when families are gathering together to celebrate your birth, Christ, there's going to be several families for whom this year there will be a hole. Somebody's seat at the table isn't filled. Somebody's place in our heart, Lord, is empty because they've gone. They've died. And Lord, we need you to come and comfort us. And we pray that you would do that for Inky and Darren and their loss, but many of us as well who are experiencing loss in this season. For Jan and Ivan, Lord, we pray for Ivan's healing for his body and patience, Lord, as he'll spend all his days, even through Christmas. We pray for Jan, that if Ivan spends his days at the hospital, that you will, bring, Lord, her company and comfort. She struggles with her own illnesses and trials. We lift her to you. And we pray too, Lord, that you will bring individuals into these positions of youth and worship, and that we could have, permanent people fill those. And so we lift those needs to you as well in our community. And we pray, Lord, as we get these invite cards in at the end of our service time, that you will lead us to somebody to invite them to come to Christmas Eve. And we thank you that there's a little bit of memory in people's heart, or an inclination in people's heart, to come to a church on Christmas Eve. And we pray for our community, for those who belong to their congregation, that they will go. For those who don't, that, Lord, they might come here or somewhere. We pray that, Lord, you would use us as missionaries in our community with these invite cards. And, Lord, with our lives that we live and with the words that we speak, might we be missionaries to a part of your work to draw people to yourself. From, Lord, our community and 10 miles north, south, east, and west, but also as you call us to be missionaries across the seas, use us, Lord, as missionaries, we pray. Lord, we lift our hearts to you today, and we bless your name. And thank you now, Lord, for what you've been doing and working in Gavin's life. And we pray that, Lord, your name would be exalted and glorified now, but also throughout his life as he grows to know you, love you, serve you more and more. We love you, Jesus, and lift our hearts to you. And all God's people said, amen, amen. Well, this is a joyful occasion that we have today to celebrate what God's doing in Gavin. Friends, the scriptures say this, and Jesus spoke, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always to the end of the age." The Lord teaches us in his word that there's one body, one spirit, just as you are called to one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all. And the Lord said to also teaches us in his word, he says, "Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him by baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in the newness of life." And that God also establishes his covenant with us. He says, "I will establish my covenant between me and you and your offspring after you throughout their generations, for an everlasting covenant to be God to you and to your offspring after you." And Peter said in the first sermon recorded in the scriptures, "For the promise is for you, for your children, and for all who are far away, everyone whom the Lord our God calls to him." Now, Gavin, what, you're 15 right now, right? 14, okay. We won't rush it for your parents too quickly, right? 14 years ago, Jared and Gina stood up here with their first child in their family. It was a happy moment, wasn't it, Gary and AD? Grandma, it was a happy moment. And there were promises that were made, promises that you, the congregation, made, promises that, mom and dad, you made, but there were promises that God made. And we see those promises of God coming to fruition. Because God promises in baptism by grace alone to forgive our sins, to adopt us into the body of Christ, the church, to send the Holy Spirit daily to renew and cleanse us, and to resurrect us unto eternal life. And that promise was made in the water of baptism. Now, we know that water cleanses, it refreshes, it sustains. And how much more so is Jesus Christ the living water. Yet when we fall into sin, we're not to despair, we're not to get nervous, because God sends us His mercy. Nor should we continue into sin, for baptism is the sign and seal of God's eternal covenant of grace with us, His people. And so the elders of First Reformed Church have welcomed Gavin, who appeared before them, made his profession of faith in Jesus Christ. And I'm going to invite Gavin to come forward, and Gary as grandpa, but as also as elder, to help administer this profession of faith. Stand right up here with me, Gavin. Get a little taller. All right. Gavin, you've come before us to make your profession of faith. I'm going to ask you, as before God and Christ Church, to reject evil, to profess your faith in Jesus Christ, and to confess the faith of the church. Do you renounce sin and the power of evil in your life and in the world?
Yes.
And who is your Lord and Savior, Gavin?
Jesus Christ.
Jesus Christ. And Gavin, will you be a faithful member of this congregation through worship and service and seek to advance God's purposes here in Northwest Iowa and throughout the world?
Yes.
You will. I'm going to ask the congregation, would you please stand? Do you, as Christ's body of the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Jesus Christ? If this is what you reaffirm, please say, we do.
We do.
And do you promise to love and encourage and support Gavin by teaching the gospel of God's love, by being an example of Christian faith and character, and by giving the strong support of God's family in fellowship, prayer, and service? If this is what you promise, please say, we do. And Gavin, do you promise to accept the spiritual guidance of the church, to walk in a spirit of Christian love with this congregation, and to seek those things that make for unity, purity, and peace?
I do.
You do. Wonderful. Well, with one voice, let's recite the words of the Apostles' Creed. With one voice we say, I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there He shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Friends, please be seated. Thank you. Well, Gavin, 14 years ago, you stood up here not even knowing what was happening. Yep. And that's the way God works. He works in our lives before we even realize it. In baptism, you were sealed by the Spirit. You were marked as a child of God's covenant, and at that time engaged to profess faith in Jesus Christ. And now with your profession of faith, Gavin, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, the only King and Head of the Church, you are a child of the living God, received into the visible membership of the Holy Christian Church. You are confessing the faith in Jesus Christ and called to be God's faithful servant until your life's end. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let's pray. Please pray with me. And Lord, defend your servant Gavin. Defend him with your heavenly grace. Lord, that I pray he may continue to be yours forever. And I pray that you would also daily increase in his life more and more of your Spirit until he comes to your eternal kingdom through Jesus Christ our Lord. Lord, this is the beginning of a chapter in his life that we pray that you will continue to write, not only, Lord, through the years of growing into adulthood, but Lord, as one day we pray he might be married and one day bring forth children, make him, Lord, or give him, Lord, all the wisdom he needs to one day raise his children to know you and love you as well. We bless you for what you're doing, Lord, and thank you for doing it in Gavin. In Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people said, amen. Friends, by the Holy Spirit, we're all who believe and are baptized receive a ministry to witness to Jesus Christ, Savior and Lord. And we stand in a tradition where God calls men and women to do so and to join his mission of redemption in the world. And now, Gavin, you're part of that mission now too. We're ambassadors for Jesus, who reconciles and makes the world whole. We are the salt of the earth and the light of the world. Gavin, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen? Amen. Amen. Let's give the Lord a round of applause for what he's doing in Gavin. Grandpa, you can shake his hand, give him a hug. And there is a certificate just marking the occasion, Gavin, and certain all the words that we just read. This is a big day. You don't go away too quickly. So, yeah, God's making you a missionary now. At school, in the community, time to live and continue to live for Him. Amen? Amen. Gavin, you can have a seat. Praise God for what He's doing in Gavin's life. It's a good day. It's a good day for all that God is doing and drawing people to Himself. Well, we're going to turn our hearts to song again, but we're also going to bring our gifts to the King. And, you know, we give. One of the reasons we give is for this. We say we're building God's kingdom one life at a time. Part of what we give is see our children to grow to know and love Jesus. You know, we make those promises. This is part of keeping the promises. There's three ways to give. You can give now during the service through the blue bags, or you can give online. Some of you gave last week when we didn't even have church, through the electronic giving, which was pretty cool. Pretty cool. You can do that through text. The instructions are on the screen, or click on the Give tab on the church website. But let's give to see more professions of faith happen, to build God's kingdom one life at a time.
Over the skies of Bethlehem appeared a star, while angels sang to lowly shepherds. Three wise men seeking truth who traveled from afar, hoping to find the child from heaven. Falling on their knees, they bow before the humble Prince of Peace. I bring an offering of worship to my King. No one on earth deserves the praises that I sing. Jesus, may you receive the honor that you're due. Oh Lord, I bring an offering to you. The sun cannot compare to the glory of your love. There is no shadow in your presence. No mortal man would dare to stand before your throne, before the Holy One of Heaven. It's only by your blood, it's only through your mercy, Lord, I come. I bring an offering of worship to my King. No one on earth deserves the praises that I sing. Jesus, may you receive the honor that you're due. No one on earth deserves the praises that I sing. Jesus, may you receive the honor that you're due. Oh Lord, I bring an offering to you. Oh Lord, I bring an offering to you.
Amen. Thanks, worship team. Hey, kids, if you're 4 years older in kindergarten, whoa, hold on. If you're 4 years older in kindergarten, I need you to come to me, and then I'll send you to Miss Brenda. So come on down. Kids, I need your help. I need your help. I really do. If you're 4 years older in kindergarten, yeah, Jace, you come. Come. I need your help this morning. I need your help. Come on down. And just kind of, why don't you guys sit right here. Just kind of sit on the steps right here. All right? I've got something for you. Yeah, move it. There you go. All right. Come on this way. Come and scooch down a little bit. Scooch this way a little bit. Do I got you? Everybody here? Oh, we got a couple. All right. Come on down. All right. I need a little help. We got to light some candles, and I need some help. Any of you guys tall enough to reach up there? Right here. These candles right here. Right here. Logan, you can't even see them. You're sitting underneath them. Can you help me with that? Can you reach up there? Nope, not tall enough. I guess I'll have to do it. Well, you're going to have to help me a little bit. What is this thing, kids? What is that? It's a stick. Yes, it is a stick. It's a particular kind of stick. You know what kind of stick?
Staff.
It's a staff. Yeah, it's a shepherd's staff, isn't it? Yeah, it's a shepherd's staff, and sometimes shepherds use this when they're keeping track of their sheep. You want to be my sheep, Jace? Okay, good. I thought you would. Now, you can be a standing up sheep so everybody can see you. So, you know, what a shepherd would do, he'd take his staff like this, and then he'd, you know, if you walk that way. All right? Oh, not that fast. No, keep walking. So if I tap you this way, I want you to go that way. If I tap you this way, I want you to go that way. See, and the shepherd, okay, that's good. That's good. Now I'll pull you back. No, I won't do that. Come on, you can sit back down. Yeah, but they would use that to help, they rescue their sheep. Sometimes they kind of have to grab them by the leg to pull them a little bit. They would do that. This is a shepherd's staff because we're talking about shepherds today. Now, we missed church last Sunday, didn't we? Nope. Yeah, we did. And we were going to talk about how Jesus is the light and how we're called to go and search for the light. Today, we're talking about how God helps us to discover the light. Now, do you know the story about the shepherds? They were out watching their sheep, and all of a sudden there was this big bright light. Ah! And they were a little afraid. The angel said to them, "Today in the city of David is born to you a Savior who is Christ the Lord." And he would be a baby. He'd be in a manger wrapped in swaddling clothes. Yeah, but and so what do you think happened with some of the sleepy shepherds when that angel showed up? What do you think? Were they excited, scared? They were nervous. Yeah, and I think they woke up pretty quickly. And the guys who were already awake, they're probably really nervous and afraid. Because the angel said, don't be afraid. Well, they went, those shepherds went and found Jesus. And the Bible calls Jesus the light of the world. Now, over on the Christmas tree, see all those lights? Now, we have all those lights because at this season of the year, we remember that Jesus is the light of the world. Does anybody have a night light in your room?
Yeah.
I used to have a nightlight. You know why I had a nightlight? I was scared. I was scared of the dark. My bedroom was in the basement. I was scared. There's funny sounds downstairs. And light helps us, gives us comfort. Light also, if we were in a dark cave and the lights weren't on, we couldn't see. But with the lights, we can see. And that was, what? Yeah, but see, you need a light to be able to see. Yeah, I know. And Jesus is like because he shows us the truth to know what's right about who he is and what God's doing in the world. But he also gives us comfort and gives us hope as well. And the shepherds went to go look for Jesus, who is called the light. And during Advent, in preparation for Christmas, this is where you all look up here. We light these candles to remind us that Jesus is the light of the world. And today we're learning that not only is Jesus the light and that we need to search for the light. Oh, come on. Anybody got a lighter? Or a match? Oh. You know, it works always with first service. I think the fans are on up. Okay, well, we'll pretend that's lit. There we go. We got that one. Let's see if we can do this now. Well, when do you just give up and let it go? Oh, we got it. There we go. We light these candles to remind us that Jesus is the light, and today to discover the light. And shepherds went to discover the light. They heard the message, and they went and they ran. Now, we're going to pray in just a little bit, okay? When we're done praying, I have something special to give to you, all right? And you each get something. Excited? Yeah. And every week I've got something to give to you. So let's pray. Oh, Ari doesn't want to miss out on the gift. All right, that's fine. You sit down right there, Ari. Okay. All right, so what do we do when we pray? We're going to hold our hands so our hands aren't busy touching other things and other people. We're going to close our eyes too so we can focus, all right? Lord, help us to discover who you are, you, the light of the world. And I pray for these children, Lord, that this season would be a joyful season with celebrations, but joyful, Lord, because of all that you have done for us. So please continue to grow them to know you and love you and give wisdom, Lord, to their parents to help them know you, love you, and serve you all their days. And all God's kids said?
Amen.
That wasn't very enthusiastic. And all God's kids said?
Amen.
And all God's kids said?
Amen.
We'll work on that. All right. I've got something special for you, okay? So make a line behind Logan. And you guys can go back to your moms and dads. I have two little ornaments in each of these bags. One says, search for the light. And the other one says, today says, discover the light. Now you can hang these on your Christmas tree. Once you get your bag, you can head back to your mom and dad. You can hang those on your Christmas tree at home as a reminder to search for Jesus and discover Jesus, who's the light. There you go. There you go. Girls, oop. There you are. There you go. There you go. Wonderful. And thanks for coming up and helping me light those candles. There you are, ladies. And last but not least, there you go. Thanks so much. Thank you, thank you. All right. You know, it's good to have kids involved in part of the worship. And kids, you can go right back to Mrs. Brenda, and she'll take you down to Children and Worship in room 21 in the basement. All right, I've got a little quiz here. This, and I don't try to make things, you know, history lessons. But what happened in 1849? And if you're a 49ers fan from San Francisco, that should be a little bit of a clue. All right, what happened in 1849? All right, do I got some bidders? Who's got? Okay. Yes, the gold rush. That was the big gold rush that happened. It actually began in 1848 was when gold was actually discovered in California. And it was in 1949 that there was just this huge influx of people into California. At that time, in 1848 and 49, California was not a state. But in 1849, 300,000 people went to California, and there was 300,000 people from the East Coast, from Oregon. People came from Europe to California for gold. They came from Mexico. They came all the way across the Pacific Ocean from China. All these people came. And in 4 short years, California was just sort of a province or a territory. 4 short years, not only was it a state, but they were nominating people to be, I think it was the vice president of the United States. In 4 short years, when they discovered gold in California, the news just spread like wildfire. And everybody was so excited about it. It not only did it have, you know, impacts for them as a state, but because of the gold that was discovered in California, it had an economic impact across the whole nation because they discovered this gold. Now, They're just kind of shiny rocks sitting in the ground. But the Lord has given to us a son who was born to us. He is Christ the Lord. Gold can't buy us eternity. Gold can't buy us what our hearts long and desire for. Only the Lord can. And he's calling us to discover today the light that is Jesus in our series Called to Shine. Would you please turn with me in your copy of the scriptures to Luke chapter 2. We're going to read from verse 8 to verse 20. That is the portion of the birth story of Jesus that speaks of the shepherds. There's a lesson in here for us in Luke chapter 2. Now, let's see. Some of us are, you know, have reached the 60-year mark in our lives. Some of us have reached the 70-year mark in our lives. Has anybody in the room hit the 80-year mark? Not here, but in first service this morning. We've got a few bids for 80. Okay, all right. So some of it, how many times, if you've been 60, 70, or 80, you know, years or more, how many times have you heard this account, what we're about to read? 60, 70, or 80 times, probably. Yeah, exactly. That's my point. Even if we're 30 or 35 or 10 or 15, We've heard this account of Jesus' birth probably that many times, if not more. Now, here's what I'm going to ask you to do this morning. Because we're so familiar with this scripture text, that can actually get in our way of understanding the depth of it that God wants to show us. So I'm going to ask you, try not to do that. Try not to say, oh yeah, I remember that. Or, oh yeah, I remember that. Allow your eyes to see it for the first time and your hearts to hear it for the first time as though you've never, ever experienced it before. Luke chapter 2, we're going to put our hearts and minds attention to verse 8 through verse 20. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and they had gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby, who was lying in the manger. And when they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying, praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. Gary, please pray us in.
Lord, our prayer this morning is that your spirit will rest on Pastor Paul as he prepares to give us your words. We just pray that he may speak the words that you want him to say,
yes,
and that your spirit will also rest in our hearts, that we can receive your message. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thanks, Gary. So when gold was discovered, there's a big ruckus. Everybody was excited. The whole state of California quickly came to fruition. The economy of the United States was booming because of that gold, because all the money we had then was silver and gold. It wasn't anything else. And something very similar happened in the account we just read of the shepherds. Let's walk through it together. I want to make some observations and draw some conclusions for us as God's called us to shine and to discover the light that is Jesus. All right, look with me back at the scriptures at verse 8. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks by night. No big deal, right? Because this happened all the time. If you were there at that time, you would often, if not every night, see shepherds watching their sheep out in the field. This is pretty common, and these guys had done it once, twice, and a million times before. But then you get to verse 9, and if you were in their shoes, you would have the same experience. Verse 9 says, "And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified." Now take a time out. Put yourself in their shoes. It's dark. You're half asleep, leaning on your staff, watching these sheep all night long. Suddenly, this angel appears, bright and shining. Wouldn't you be a little bit afraid? Be honest. You would be terrified. All right? You'd be shaking in your boots. I know you would, because we all would. Because that's, number one, it's not what we expect. Number two is, this is weird, because this is an inbreaking of the unseen realm, the realm in which God lives and exists. It's an inbreaking of the unseen realm into ours, and this rarely happens. But it does happen occasionally through Scripture. And almost every time an angel comes to whoever they come to, now in the case of the shepherds, everybody's terrified. Just outright terrified. But the angel says, verse 10, "Don't be afraid. I'm not sitting here to condemn you." But he says, "I bring you good news of great joy." All right. I still imagine they're a little afraid. Good news of great joy that will be for all people. Let's take a time out right there. This is really important for us to know. It's good news of great joy for all people. Now, oftentimes when we're reading this, what we're thinking, this is good news for these guys, the shepherds. Right? I mean, I'm thinking that. And that's true. Now, what we also need to know about the shepherds is they really weren't high class guys. If you were putting them on the ladder of success in life, they didn't even have a rung. They were on the bottom. Nobody grew up thinking, I'm aspiring to be a really good shepherd. No, it was the last thing in the world you really wanted to do. I mean, being a garbage collector would be better than being a shepherd. And some guys love doing what they do as a garbage collector. They love that job. But shepherds, your mom did not hope that you would grow up to be a shepherd. No, no way, shape, or form. But that's to whom Jesus comes. And if we read a little scripture a little later, I mean, they tell them about who this person is. Savior, he's Christ the Lord. He's a baby wrapped in a manger. Ladies who've had children, would you dare think of putting your newborn baby in a manger, in a food trough? Now, guys, we can do our best to imagine this, but I'm pretty sure we'd come to the same conclusion. We're not going to do that. That's filthy, dirty, and disgusting. But it points to a truth that goes back to all this message is for all people. Jesus comes to the lowliest of people because he's for all people. He comes for all people. This good news of great joy is for all people. It's, the shepherds who just nobody knows. We don't even know these guys' names. Have no clue. That means he also comes for the nameless homeless person who's living on the street in L.A. or the transient who walks through Sheldon. It's good news of great joy for them. It's good news of great joy for the rich and the wealthy who have plenty of money for themselves and sometimes give it away, but sometimes they hoard it up for themselves. Like the people that Jesus would, or the person that Jesus would one day meet who wanted to follow Jesus, and Jesus says, well, sell all you have and give it to the poor. The guy walked away sad because he had a lot of things. And Jesus concluded, it's harder for a rich man to enter, or it's easier for a camel to walk through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter into heaven. But Jesus comes for all people. He comes for all the people, white English-speaking people such as ourselves. He comes for, brown Spanish-speaking people, many of our neighbors. He comes for the Tutsi, the Hutus in Africa, warring tribes that never have gotten along. He comes to them to make peace. He comes to the Hindu in India. I got a story to share with you in a little bit about a Muslim man who came to faith in Jesus. He comes to the gangsters who deal with drugs and firearms and who make a living in fights and knocking off their worst enemies. God comes to those people too. This is good news of great joy for them. He comes to the capitalists, the socialists, the communists, and anarchists. He comes to us all. The conservatives, the liberals, he comes to us all. The irreligious who don't want anything to do with God, he comes to them. This is good news of great joy for all people. That's the first note we need to see. If there's anything that we walk away from with today, this is the thing that God wants us to take home. Friends, this one. God's message of good news of great joy is a call out to all people. It's for the shepherds in the story. It's also for Herod, who wants to kill Jesus too. Some of them respond, some of them don't, but the message is for all people. I got a couple stories I want to share with you in just a little bit. But let's keep walking through the scriptures. So that message is that in the town of David, verse 11, a Savior has been born to you. This means he's a Savior for all people, the gangsters, the homeless, people who don't look like us, people who live in big cities. Savior to them, Savior to us. He's Christ. He's God's anointed one to bring this to pass, but he's also the Lord. Now, how are the shepherds going to know? There could be several babies in Bethlehem. How are they going to know that this one is the right one? Well, the Lord gives them instruction. Verse 12, you'll find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. That's the one. That's the one. Now, I'm impressed what happens next. Okay, so the guys get the message. And then and when they hear that from the angel, then what was terrifying enough becomes a little more terrifying, because now it's not just one angel, now it's several angels, and they're gathering together in verse 14, and they're singing, glory to God in the highest, on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests. Why glory to God? Because God's drawing people from all nations to himself, all peoples. The homeless, the gangster, the white people, the brown people, the black people, the Hindus. God changes and transforms hearts and draws people to himself through his son. And they people, who were Muslims become Christians. And he draws them to himself. It's for all people, including the lowly people like the shepherds. So It is about as quick as we read what happened. I'm sure that's about as quick as the experience was for the shepherds who are out there. God's messages usually are quick and short and to the point, and that's it. So what do we happens? Verse 15. This is absolutely important for us to hear. When the angels had left them and had gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Hey, Joe, Bob, Billy, let's go see this thing. Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord told us about." So they're excited. Hey, Parker, Kobe, let's go. But they didn't hesitate. Now, Parker, they're like, Mom and Dad, am I supposed to do that? Can I really go with Pastor Paul? No, you guys stay right where you're at. But that's what's going on. They have this experience. They see this angel. And they're like, let's go do it. Let's go. And so we get to verse 16. So they hurried off. I imagine they got their staffs in their hands. Let's go. We're out of here. Did they leave their sheep behind? I suppose. It says that they hurried. And they ran into town to find out. This is important for us because the response of the shepherds is key to us who have been following Jesus. It's key to our experience. The shepherds show us today how to respond to this call from God. This call goes out to all people. A Savior has been born to you. The shepherds show us how to respond. Here's the first thing. It's go. Go and discover Jesus, the light of the world, the one who brings truth, the one who brings hope, the one who brings comfort, the one who leads us to the Father. Go! And so they throw it on, and they just, let's go. And they leave. So often, we're like Kobe and Parker. And I'm going to pick on you guys for a second, right? You are doing what your mom and dad told you to do. You're like, can I go? They're getting permission from mom and dad. So often, we kind of dilly-daddle. Should I really go? Should I really follow? Should I immediately respond? Many times we do that and we miss the opportunity. The shepherds don't miss the opportunity, though. They go immediately and discover Jesus, the light of the world. But then there's something else. Not only do they go, here's the next thing. They go and when they're coming back, they tell others so others can discover Jesus. Look at verse 17. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. They went, they saw the baby wrapped in the manger, wrapped in clothes. And then when they're done, they're going back. Hey, everybody, look. This is what happened. We saw an angel. The angel told us about this baby. He's God's anointed one. He's in the manger. We saw it. And verse 18, what are the people doing? And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. This is amazing. Were there people who doubted? Ah, come on. I'm sure there's people. But those who heard them, the shepherds, they were amazed. Now, they might amaze. Well, why would God use these shepherds? That might be why they're amazed. But the scriptures say it's very clear. They're amazed at what they had told them. So they go and discover it is what God said it would be, this baby wrapped in cloths lying in a manger. But their response then is to tell others so they can discover Jesus too. Got two stories for you. First story is about Amal. Amal grew up in Pakistan. And Pakistan's a majority Muslim country. He was a Muslim himself. And a Muslim who was particularly given over to seeking after the truth. He wanted truth. And he had special access to that truth because his uncle was an imam who lived in the same house with him. And so he would ask his uncle some hard questions and, you know, his uncle would give answers, but they just weren't satisfying his heart. And he was met one day with a good friend of his, and Amal shared his frustration seeking after truth and not finding it. His friend says to him, who is a fellow Muslim, who said, you know, I've been studying the Bible lately. You want to study the Bible with me? And Amal says, yeah, I do. And so he began to study the scriptures. Over a course of, you know, a few months, he comes to the conclusion, Jesus is the Lord and there is no other. There is, Allah is nothing. Jesus is everything. And you know what he did? He did the same thing the disciples are doing, or excuse me, the shepherds are doing right here. He saw, and he believed, and he went to his villagers, his fellow villagers, told them about Jesus. And then he went to the next village, telling them about Jesus. Soon, pretty quickly, the word gets out that Amal, your son, your nephew, he's telling people about Jesus, the Christian Jesus. And so Amal comes home one day. There stands his uncle, who's the imam in town, mom and dad. Says, you recant about Jesus, or you're not living in this house again. He says, I can't do this. He believes. He can't do it. And so you're gone. They kicked him out. He has nowhere to go. Nowhere to go. So he spends a few nights on his own, realizes he can't do that. And finally, for six years, he sneaks at nighttime. He'd sneak up onto the roof of his parents' house and spend the night on the roof. In the summertime, that worked out great. Wintertime, it was pretty cool. And he would go to village and tell people about Jesus. That's what the shepherds are doing. That's what they're doing. Here's another story. This one's about Renee. Renee is he's a gangster of gangsters. I mean, there's a new documentary about this gentleman. His name, Renee Martinez from L.A. And Renee, a gangster of gangsters. And I would show you the clip about him, except that we have too many kids and I don't want them to have bad dreams tonight. Nothing really bad, nothing you haven't seen in any movie. There's just too much, a little more violence than I want to show on a Sunday morning. You get what I mean? You can look at his story. Renee, it's called The Level Warrior. It's a documentary about his life. At 14, he started a gang called the Latin Syndicate. At 14, this is in southern Florida and in L.A. The Latin Syndicate. Drugs, guns, the whole bit. He grew old enough in his early 20s to have a daughter, and he realized, my life's got to change. And so he turned away from the drugs and guns thing to make money and began fighting, bare-knuckled fighting. And then you can see the videos. That's partly, I don't want to show it to the kids. He's beating up people and making a lot of money. Soon he turns it to martial arts fighting, MMA they call that, and that leads into making gangster music. And then he has this experience from Jesus, and I'm going to put it here in his own words. He says, I was recording gangster music in my garage, and he heard Jesus speak to him saying, I spared you for such a time as this. He says, I've had a gun jammed in my face. I've had bullets whistle by my ears. I almost died 5 or 6 times. He says, all my friends died. God set me free for a reason. And at that moment, he repented. But it was 3 years later that he was baptized, and his life changed from that. He says, I went into the water when it was April 10, 2016, and that day my life shifted. He said, this is his words, not mine. I ain't never been the same. Something incredible in my life happened that I can't explain. It was Jesus. Only Jesus can do it. And now he walks the streets of Southern California, particularly in L.A., to all of his older, former gangsters and gangbangers, the whole bit, preaching about Jesus. And he says specifically, I teach them about Jesus and repentance through his name and salvation in his name alone. Wow! On the streets of LA, he's preaching about Jesus. The guy's all tatted up. You would probably look at him and Sheldon and think, who is that weirdo? Here's a weirdo for Jesus. He's just like the shepherds. Just like the shepherds. He heard. And what did he respond? He tells others so they can discover Jesus. He went to his second in command in his old gang, the Latin Syndicate, went to the second in command, began to tell him about Jesus, and had the opportunity to baptize that guy. And he left the whole gangster life because now his life is for Jesus. That, my friends, is our responsibility, to tell other people about Jesus. Our time is short, so let's wrap this up here pretty quick, all right? Here's what we need to do today. This is God's call, what he's asking us. He's asking us to heed his call to discover who Jesus is, a Savior born to you. Friends, I don't want us to get caught in the commercialization of this Advent Christmas season. It's so easy to get caught up in our decorations, to get caught up in the gift giving, to get caught up in all the parties, and those are great and they're fine. But if we have missed God's call on our lives to believe and trust in this baby that was born and was born to die and rise again on the third day, we've missed it all. Discover who Jesus is, a Savior born to you all and to you each individually. Heed God's call. Respond to it. Today, if you've never made a pledge to Christ to put your trust and faith in him, today is the day. I want to talk to you. I want to meet you in the back. I'll be back there after worship. You just come find me. Let's talk. Heed that call. Secondly, this would be a lot of us in the room. It's time to tell people about Jesus. You know, tell people about tell people about who you have seen and heard about Jesus. You know, this opportunity we have with these little invite cards, this is a great way to start, and this is the perfect time of the year. It's a great way to start the conversation. Now, some of us, we've never really done that before, and it makes us a little bit nervous, but that's okay. That's okay. God will give us the word. We can be like Renee. We can be like Amal. We can be like these shepherds who tell people about Jesus. Will we tell everything smoothly, articulately? Probably not. But we still have the opportunity to do so. And this time of the year, people's hearts are in a different spot. They're more inclined to hear the truth about him. It's the Christmas season. So let's tell, let's invite, let's share about Jesus. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. And Lord, we pray that you will do more through our efforts to tell, to share about you than what we could imagine. And some of us, Lord, we've got this number one on our list here, to heed your call, to discover who you are, Jesus, a Savior born to us, each of us personally, to all of us together. And friend, if you are that person today, let your heart be open to what's going on in your heart now, that God would move you to trust in him. If you are that person, let's meet after worship. I'll be in the back. You'll know me. So Father, move sovereignly and draw people to yourself for the glory of your name, we ask. And all God's people said, amen.
Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies. With angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Hail the hand-born Prince of Peace, hail the Son of Righteousness, light and life to all he brings, risen with healing in his wings. Love he lays his glory by, for that man no more may die, born to raise the sons of earth, born to give him second birth. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King.
Friends, go with God's blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you and give you peace. Amen?
Amen.
Go in peace.